right here, right now. Every day, CIUT 89.5, the sound of your city. Toronto.
Hey, good evening and welcome to HOWL. This is your host for the hour, Nancy Jane Bullis Greer, coming at you live from our studio here at Heart House on this absolutely beautiful September evening. Thank you so much for listening. We have a great show tonight, so I hope you can stick around for the hour. We're going to be speaking first with Ingrid Ruthig with her book of poetry, her debut book of poetry called This Being, and then we'll be speaking to two poets in Ottawa. We'll be speaking first with Sandra Ridley and with her recent publication coming out with Book Thug. And then we will be speaking with poet Monty Reid, who is also in Ottawa, with his book from Brick Books, which is also brand new. So please stick around for that. But first, I'd like to welcome Ingrid Ruthig to the studio. Hey, Ingrid.
Hey, Nancy. It's nice to be here.
Oh, thank you for coming out tonight. It's really great to have you here. And just for people who may not be familiar with Ingrid, I'll just read her bio, that Ingrid earned a Bachelor of Architecture at the University of Toronto in the 1980s and practiced the profession for more than a decade. Her work as a writer, editor, and artist has appeared widely, with poems in the Best Canadian Poetry in English and many other publications across Canada and abroad. She is the author of the poem sequence and artist book Slipstream, the chapbook Synesthete.
That's it.
Synesthete 2. And editor of The Essential, Anne Wilkinson, Richard Outram Essays on His Works, as well as a forthcoming volume on the work of David Helwig. She lives near Toronto. So that's a busy area that you're working in. You're writing
Absolutely, and editing. I like to keep myself busy, and having several projects sort of fits with my background, too. So if something goes a little stagnant for a while or just slows up, I can move on to something else and work on that. So
yeah,
I'm used to it.
You're used to it.
Yeah.
So were you always writing, or is this something that you worked on more after you, when you weren't practicing, when you weren't an architect anymore?
Not really. I just did a print interview with my hometown newspaper, and that was kind of fun. But one of the questions was I exposed to poetry when I was younger, or literary arts? And it made me think about that. And I thought, no, I didn't really write. I didn't want to write essays in school and would leave it right to the last minute. But I always was a huge reader, and I loved literature. And I kind of stopped when I was at school here. You're working so much on your projects and whatnot. I stopped reading for pleasure pretty much entirely. And then it was quite a lot later, after I had kids, and I got kind of connected with some writers in the States, and they said, hey, maybe you should be doing this. And I always thought the idea of writing a book was pretty cool, but didn't really consider it as a serious thing. So it's kind of a new thing, but not really. I feel a lot of times like it's just a journey, and I'm following my nose.
Oh, that's nice. That's a nice way to put it. And just sort of cropped up in the path, and you followed it, and here you are.
Even every time I start a new project, I equate it with stepping into a boat or a canoe, and you start paddling thinking you know what direction you're going in, and the current takes over, and you just never know where you're going to end up. So I just keep following the current.
I like that.
Makes it interesting.
Keeps it interesting. Yeah. Also keeps your eyes open. That you're not just closed on, well, this is what I intended to do and this is what I'm doing. You know?
Yeah, and life changes too. I mean, things change. We didn't know if we were going to have kids, and we did. And I didn't know how work was going to go. The construction industry is always very up and down with the economy. So there's an ebb and flow to things. And I don't live in this city, and once you have kids, you start considering how long a time you want to commute, and I didn't want to set up my own practice in Durham region where we're located, because that's an awful lot of work. And so you just sort of, I kind of trust in just following where things lead, but it keeps things interesting too, and I've been lucky. I've been lucky that I've had the chance to do that. So,
to do that, and for the opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
And this is your first full book of poetry.
It is.
But you have published in in several other publications.
Oh, quite a few. I've been cutting my teeth for a long time in publishing, and publishing other people's works too, because I was a co-editor and co-publisher of a literary journal that we published out of Whitby, Ontario. And it was available across Canada and internationally. And I was on the board for 9 years. And so you meet a lot of people. And in the meantime, you're also doing an awful lot of work. And at some point, you realize you're helping others along more than you're helping yourself. So
yeah, I deal with that too.
But yeah, in the meantime, as I was doing that, I was also sending my work out and landing up with quite a few publications, yeah, including doing reviews for National Post and Quill Inquirer and a lot of book industry, publishing industry publications. So yeah, I've got a.
So that gets your name out there too.
Yeah, but yeah, it comes to a point where you've got quite a lot of material, and a first book is. There's a bit of a luxury with having a first book because you do have a lot of material to choose from, but it's not something that you've stepped into with an idea in mind. So there was a lot of paper pasted on the wall outside my office at home for a lot of different times, and they got shuffled around an awful lot. But I had a very good editor at FitzHenry and Whiteside who published this particular book. So
yeah, they did a beautiful job.
Another stroke of luck. Yeah,
a very beautiful job. How did that come about? Did you send your manuscript to them?
Well, again, it's another one of these serendipitous things. I was doing some book reviews. At that time, I was an associate editor with Northern Poetry Review here in Toronto. And the editor said, can you review this particular book? And it was an anthology of modern Canadian poets, edited by two expats. One of them was Evan Jones, who teaches at the University of Bolton in the UK. And I thought, okay, I'll do it, because reviewing an anthology I found at that time a little bit daunting, but I did the review. And having gone through the School of Architecture here, I know constructive criticism as opposed to destructive reviewing. And so I tried to do fairly fair things, write fair work, and Evan got in touch with me afterwards, and he thanked me for the review. And then we just got talking, and it turns out that he was poetry editor at FitzHenry and Whiteside. And along the way, he invited me to do a reading at Ben McNally Books when they were putting out another book. And then he says, have you got some work in hand? And so it's one of these things, you keep doing what you're doing, and you hope for a little bit of luck along the way. And it's been very cool working with Evan. I really enjoyed it. And sometimes as a writer, you get so close to the trees, you don't see the forest anymore.
Sure.
You need someone to nudge you away from the bark.
Oh, it's true. Editors have a very important role to play, and they really are that first reader and can really see the book as a whole, as sometimes I don't think as the creator that you can, and are maybe can help sculpt when a book needs to be sculpted.
Yes, and it's something too that you can't plan in advance. There's a rapport, a relationship that you hopefully establish with your editor as well. And you may not always be on exactly the same path, but you're aimed in the same direction. So we had a lot of transatlantic long-distance phone calls, but they were fabulous. I really enjoyed them, and it helped me step away from things and just make sure that if I said I didn't agree with something, I had a reason for it. And I think it really helped just pull the whole thing together. And so I was very grateful to have that opportunity.
I'll just read from the back in the blurb. It says, in this, her debut collection, Ingrid Ruthig records the ebbs and flow of individual life through time, landscape, and our collective existence, how we connect with the past, where we are now, and despite our inherent separateness, our personal convergences. These are what lay ahead on this journey. Ingrid also explores our need to create, to build a deeper sense of self, of belonging, questioning, observing, then striving to respond. Her voice is confident, concentrated, wry. This is a book of poems about the dynamic of being and our shifting perception of who we are from one moment to the next. And I read that because I couldn't say it any better than that. but you really you like people. I get that sense, and their journeys I guess their perspective, or trying to, sometimes you try to fit into their shoes, or.
Yes. There are a lot of days I'm really happy to be alone. I don't mind my own company.
Me neither.
But I find people interesting, and you get talking to someone and they all have interesting stories, but we all have a place in the continuum as well. And I have a very strong sense of where I come from, ancestral roots. My mom wasn't born in Canada, so I have the other side of that story. I also have a pretty strong connection to the landscape I grew up in, which was the other side of Stratford, southwestern Ontario, and the lakes, the Great Lakes Basin. So there's all of these things. I like traveling, and I like to write outside my experience as well. It's not all built on biographical anecdotes or, you know, specific stories. It all morphs when you start to write, and it becomes something that you yourself probably weren't even you weren't aware of. You start somewhere and you think you know what it's about, and you put it aside maybe for years. Sometimes it's not even months or days, it's mm-hmm. years. You come back and you think it's not done. And so out of all of that, I start to discover other things too about myself, or about other people, or just about humanity. If it sounds a little grandiose, I don't mean it that way, because I like the personal. But all of that, we're influenced by it. We're influenced by the people around us. We're influenced by our landscape. We can't ignore it.
Well, for sure.
And that's part of why I like to travel too, because you need to have your eyes opened up again. And sometimes when you're in a place, you don't see things anymore. You have to shake things up a little bit.
Would you like to read from your book?
Sure. I think actually I'm going to start with, I'll read this one, because this has a crossover of a number of things that we've just been talking about. It's called Skin. This somber supplicant to the whims of living, age, genetics, and weather, this thin fortress, the stronghold of I, is a tension network of sensation. An ossified scaffold, it's a flexible wrapping we're packaged inside. A billboard, too, it instills, as ads do, desire, a bid for a genome meet and greet. At night, shifting across sleep's dunes, with luck it's an oasis from strain. Shield, splash page, a porous balloon loosed to time's slow deflation, it sinks to earth. In the border and creases of its maps, hints of where we've been appear, and of where from here we might go, charting the trip to Terra Incognita.
Thank you. You're listening to Ingrid Ruthig read from her book called This Being, which is published by FitzHenry and Whiteside. And the cover is, at first I thought it was a shoreline with, I guess, maybe one of the Great Lakes.
It is. It's actually taken at Rochester across the lake.
And at first I thought it was like a white, like a mechanical eye. And then I realized, I think it's a boy.
It is a boy. And a lot of people have said, what is that thing? Because you can see the rope disappearing into the water, and then it comes back, sneaks back onto shore. And it almost, one person said, it's almost like a bomb with a wick on it, like in cartoons.
Yeah, it could be that too.
But I hunted for cover art, and the photograph is actually one of a series that was just shown at the John B. Aird Gallery. It was taken by Robert Burley. And Bob taught us photography in first year university here at U of T for the Faculty of Architecture.
Wow.
And I just happened to trip across the series of photographs, and this one was perfect. It just screamed out at me. So
yeah.
I was really happy Bob agreed to have it on the cover.
On the cover.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's very striking. It's a very, very memorable image. Would you like to read another one?
Sure.
This is CIUT 89.5 FM. This is Nancy Jane Bullis-Greer here tonight. And please tune in again, same time, 10 o'clock next Tuesday for Valentino Essenza's show. And I'll be back in 2 weeks.
I'll read this one. It's got Toronto has a cameo in it. It's called Decoys. We sighted those leviathan pipes, huddled like monstrous decoys rusting up against Quinty's north shore, then suckered in, gunned the boat straight across the bay. Tugboats soon mustered them for the run up the lake to Toronto. Welded end to end underwater, they shaped a barrel sliding past the harbor mouth into the city's gullet. Old folk in a town nearby mind the winters, the water froze a mile out, and kids in wool mitts flocked onto the trick of liquid gone hard, transfixed by a show of ice volcanoes. On houses snugged in the hum of power plants, meters currently spin their dizzy compass, while steam bleeds around a sudden buckshot of ducks, peppering the waves near the shore.
Thank you. This is CIUT 89.5 FM. We're talking to Ingrid Ruthig with her book, This Being. And I have a request.
Sure.
For Doorway.
Oh, I'm glad you mentioned that one. It was actually singled out in a review that I had recently, too, and I was really tickled pink because this one's a bit of it's a hinge point for me in this collection. Doorway. A plane of passage contained by a frame hinged to the changing gate of a door, the ethos of past, present, and future. Means nothing if locked, but it's not. On one side, the were, inside, are, or the thin now of between. Through, and the future presents the self you were bound to be only moments ago. The room you left or entered doesn't matter, nor does the need for hello, goodbye. There, now behind, forward you morph into flipbook is, form renewed here and here, like pages lapsed and settling upon the other. Shapeshifter you, pulling was, like stubborn sweet taffy, into this and is.
Thank you. Yeah, I really like that piece. I think it's a
strong piece. I'm glad. That's nice to hear.
And it's. I guess I sort of feel that way too. You're always in transition.
Yeah.
They talk about the four dimensions, and there's really five, time.
Yes. Well, yeah, there's for me, it's sort of the linchpin to the whole thing, because for me, it's about. We're always changing. Everything around us is always changing. It's the only constant,
exactly.
And it's hard, but we're always morphing into the next thing, into the next second, and there's always that possibility that we could be something better the next time, or that something could be better the next time. And I like that. I think it's all, for me, it's all about possibility.
And hope.
And hope, yes.
Yeah,
yes.
Which is important. And do you have any readings coming up?
I'm trailing off a little bit now. It's been fairly busy the last few months here and there, but if you're an introvert going anywhere, it's like you're planning weeks in advance. And but I do, I'll be in Toronto again the end of November, November 28th for the Hot Sauced Poetry Words series.
Yeah, with James Stewart.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes.
Oh,
so
very
I'll
good.
I'll be back again then. In the meantime, I'm hoping to get some work done because I've got a show of my artwork, a solo show coming up next fall in Whitby at Station Gallery. So,
wow.
Got a lot of things on the go, and I got to keep working.
Yeah, good luck with that. Good luck
Thanks.
With everything. And
thanks very much.
It's been a pleasure talking to you, and good luck with your writing and your art. And
thank you. It's been great
everything.
To be here and to meet you.
Oh, very good. This is CIUT 89.5 FM. We're going to take a short break for a track from Eugene Ripper, and he's a Toronto singer-songwriter. And then we're going to be right back with Sandra Ridley to talk to her about her recent book published with Book Thug.
Stuart Black, he dresses fine. He drinks cold beer, imported wine. The best tobacco he does smoke blows away his mind to pass away the time. And the pretty young girls, they don't think twice when Stuart Black asks them, oh so nice. His breath smells sweet as a rose, sweet as a rose. His Septembers never end, seasons change his mind. He stands waiting hesitating, the clouds go drifting by. They drift so high. And the pretty young girls, they don't think twice when Stuart Black asks them, oh so nice. His breath smells sweet as a rose, sweet as a rose. One fateful night he took a drive, hit up and close to 195. He blew a tie and he did die. At his funeral we all walked by and glanced at his stone-filled eye. And the pretty young girls just couldn't resist to bend down over still one last kiss. His breath smelled sweet as a rose. They said his breath smelled sweet as a rose. It still smelled sweet as a rose. 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 Sweet as a rose.
Hey, and we're back. This is Nancy Jane Bullis Greer in the chair tonight, and I'd like to thank Chris Cabasoso and Sean Plunkett for teching. Thank you so much. Doing a great job, guys, as always. And we believe we have on the phone Sandra Ridley.
You do. Hello.
Oh, hi, Sandra. How are you?
I'm good. How are you tonight?
I'm good. Thank you.
Good.
I'll just read, introduce you to our listeners if they're not familiar.
Okay.
Multiple award-winning poet, instructor, and editor Sandra Ridley is the author of three books of poetry, Fallout, winner of a 2010 Saskatchewan Book Award and the Alfred G. Bailey Prize. Post-apothecary, finalist for the Relit and Archibald Lampman Awards, and The Counting House, published by Book Thug in 2013, finalist for the Archibald Lampman Award, and chosen as one of the top five poetry books of 2013 in Quill and Quire's Reader's Poll. In 2015, Sandra was a finalist for the K.M. Hunter Artist Award for Literature, and she lives in Ottawa.
It's a mouthful.
Thank you so much for being here or in Ottawa via telephone.
Oh, this is great. Thanks for having me. And I'm really impressed that you could say post-apothecary because half the time I can't even say that myself. So
I did hesitate. I don't know. I kind of went, okay.
No, it was great. Yeah.
So it's good that your books are well-received, obviously.
It seems like. I'm not sure how that quite happens because it's so subjective out there, but it seems like some of my books seem to be reaching the right people at the right time.
Well, that's a good way of putting it.
Yeah.
Yeah. This book, just read from the back, grief is personal and unpredictable. No two people experience it the same way, and yet each person that comes out the other side is transformed by their experience of loss and redemption.
Mm-hmm.
In a sequence of five feverish elegies, Sandra Ridley's, and this is what I meant to ask you, is it Sylvia?
Sylvia, yeah.
Sylvia.
It's actually a Latvian form of Sylvia.
Okay, I wasn't sure. It's S-I-L-V-I-J-A.
Yeah.
And I wasn't sure if the J was silent or...
Yeah.
It is, okay.
Yeah.
And Sylvia is a linguistic embodiment of the traumas of psychological suffering, physical abuse, and terminal illness. Pulsing with the award-winning writer's signature blend of fervor and sang-froid, the serial poems in Sylvia accrue into a testament to a grief both personal and human, leaving readers with the redemptive grace that comes from poetry's ability to transmute chaos into meaning. And I think that's one of the things that poetry, more than any art form, can do, is take something that may not be tangible for a movie or for a novel, but it evokes something that works in poetry.
That's definitely the hope, and the hardest part is trying to figure out exactly how to transfer those types of emotions to the page. How do you do that? It's pretty much impossible because the emotions are felt. So that was my biggest curiosity about writing this book, is that looking at all these dark themes, which is sort of what I do on a consistent basis, it seems. But I want to get better and better at transforming that type of atmosphere to something textual, and then being able to leave the reader feeling something, and also being affected by it myself through the process, and maybe getting some healing for me and maybe for other people if I'm lucky.
The book is beautiful. It's a square, I think.
It is a square, yeah. BookThug did a really fantastic job on the graphic design,
really
layout and everything. Yeah, I feel very lucky.
I'm not sure if it's a painting or it almost looks like a forest.
It does, and that's the intention. It's actually a dry point etching done by Eric Slankis. So it's kind of
beautiful.
Like a lithograph, only
okay.
It was done with some plexiglass, and he cut deep into the plexiglass and then filled it with ink and then did a run of prints on that. So it is a forest, and then the image is inverted depending on which side of the cover you're looking at.
And throughout the book, too, you and maybe this is part of the emotional aspect of it, is your use of the space, of the white space.
Yeah, it's I guess it's that sense of emptiness, of longing, room for the breath,
yeah,
and then a lot of times I'm using these slashes to cut through my lines, and it's like these little snippets of breath being caught, or little cuts through the line, just like what would happen with human emotion
that is disjointed in some way.
Yeah, so the book is titled Sylvia, and it was I had a friend that was diagnosed with terminal brain cancer back in 2011, and her name was Sylvia, so much of the book is dedicated to her. And she used to live in, well, not completely live, but she was there half the year at a little cottage that was next to where the cottages that I go to. And we became very close over the last 20 years. And so when she died, quite quickly, within 4 months of her diagnosis, then that kind of became the instigation or the catalyst for starting some work, because I wanted to address that change in her life and in my life, in our lives. And so it started with that, and then other things started accumulating along the way.
Did you show any of these poems to her?
I did not get a chance to show very many of them. Maybe a part of one section was written just before she had died. It was a part of a commission for some artwork being presented for an Ottawa photographer named Pedro Idson, and I had responded to his work. His father had just been placed into a long-term care facility, so he was dealing with a lot of these similar types of emotions.
Yeah.
So it just seemed to all coalesce. Yeah. So
and the there's like a recurring theme throughout. There's a section in praise of the healer, and then you have another section, and then you come back to in praise of the healer.
Yeah, and that was important for me. I wanted to be able to keep coming back to that healing, because there is always somebody that helps you with that healing process or something, right? And or at least that's the hope, that there is that.
That there is somebody.
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah,
so I wanted to keep that coming back like a heartbeat. So you would have these periods of trauma or crisis or loss or however you want to define it, and then the healer would come back through and back through and back through, and then, of course, ending on that. Yeah.
And some of these poems have been published in or parts of other works?
Right. Yeah, I guess I work in a long form, so there aren't that many journals out there that publish long form pieces. So when I get a chance to submit them somewhere, then I do. So I had a couple of invitations from friends to submit for the places that they were involved with, so that worked out really well. And then last year I decided to submit to the Prairie Fire Bliss Carmen Award, because they allowed a longer form piece for submission. So I thought, well, just on the off chance that maybe it might end up in their magazine, I'd send it to them. And it did all right at that, so it was fine. And it ended up in the magazine, so it was good. Yeah, I think I got third for that.
And how did you come to publish with BookThug?
I think around 2010, BookThug had a program called the Manuscript Midwife. And they had for a midwife Phil Hall, so he was acting kind of like a mentor there.
Yeah.
So I've always really wanted to work with him, so I submitted a manuscript through their midwife program, and I ended up working with him. And 2 years later, he was now on an official capacity with BookThug, and he invited me to submit the manuscript. And this was the Counting House.
That was the Counting House.
And so that was the start of the relationship, the official one anyways. But I've always really, I've had such high respect for that press, BookThug, and I adore it, and I've always adored it. So it just felt like such a thrill, and I feel at home there with them.
Well, that's good.
Yeah, I feel very lucky.
Yeah, it's good. We're just going to take a break for some PSAs.
Sure.
And our sponsors, and then we'll be right back.
Okay.
To talk with Sandra Ridley. This is CIUT 89.5 FM. Thanks for listening.
Right here, right now, every day. CIUT 89.5, Toronto. Sound of your city.
And we're back, and we're talking with Sandra Ridley with her book of poetry called Sylvia.
Hello.
And hello. And would you like to read?
Sure, yeah. So I don't know if this is the only chance to read. If so, I'll just read. Well, I'll read the title. It's not the title poem. It was the poem for my friend Sylvia. It's called Dirge. Mm. We fail to name this right without the words for lapsing, lilies wilted in the beginning, wind caught nothing but your leaf unscrawled. Whatever we've come to collect, we can't find the undaunted, spectral, let's put it this way, transverse, the waves lengthen, ungraspable, umbral, fear departing as soon as it's spoken. We turn towards your haunting, a sallowed rustle, rustle. Slender and tenuous in the eventual velvet quell, weak pulse, no echo, silenced, narrow your eyes till now. De novo, the starburst cell, swelling in beneath the meniscus, spectrum spread, unbounded, the mind's eye dilated blue, a lake turned over in the hastened light, the noumenal final refusal held back. I'll stop there.
Oh.
Unless you want me to keep going, I don't know how much time.
Yeah, please do. I was just getting into the rhythm of it.
Okay, I'll skip a couple and then I'll yeah. Okay.
We have time.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wakeful bareness, we've seen you of this place as the raw such denial, undiscerned as an echo, unsought and left behind, the ghosted skyward as the essential sylph shadow detached from a great shade, jail eyes released to darkening night, only you are present when the heart stops. If you can't speak, write in a fissured altar, language of nerve matter, dura matter, orbit of the central axis by a crevice, scattered Venus lacunae, lamina code, cambered wisp to a fold, a tremor, footfall, rustle, shutter leaves whelming at the surface, sleep, no and no, resumed and doubling, parietal, occipital, rostrum and sulcus, unsettled, perceptible at the cleft, curved lobes and tracks, gestures, exhausted, serene. These are your August blackberries, this is my hand. Ash to water, to earth, stone turns, urn to ground. Apportion the indivisible out of dust, bone, from the lifted hold all, dead weight settled to the bottom, your whole unbearably light. Four hands on your spade, forcing the severed roots, bare earth upheaval, oathing, opening, downturned, downward, your burying spade. That which would not be buried, floated on the water, what part of your body, all of your body, water body in our wine glass. Packed scent, soothe-seekers after a fading vigil, as body bearers, ash tenders, mouths open for air in water, an elemental lull till wet transmutes till quicksilver as you head under this cusp of autumn, dive to the cold. Let's put it this way. Forgive each occlusion in my mind, rain-worn worry, run down to a lake, ineluctable, window, curtain, your eyes close, stop. Do you you understand? Do I understand? Are you laughing now? Weeping? Do you understand? I understand. This is difficult for you to say. This is difficult for you to say. And that's the end of that one.
Thank you. You're listening to Sandra Ridley read from her book of poetry called Sylvia, and it's published by Book Thug. That's a beautiful piece.
Oh, and you know what? That was the first time I've ever read from the book held in my hands. It just arrived a couple of weeks ago, so this is my first official reading. Thank you.
Oh, I'm honored.
Me too.
This is brand new.
It's totally brand new. It feels a little odd to have it in my hands, but I do like that square shape.
I do too. I was looking at it. I don't know why at first I thought, is it square? Is it almost square?
And then yeah.
I went, yeah, it's square. But I guess with the diagonal lines on the cover, it's
a little deceiving.
It's a little deceiving, yeah.
As it should be.
Very clever.
Yeah.
So this book has not been launched yet?
No. The Toronto launch is actually in November, so it's a little ways away, November 10th at the Garrison.
We'll be here before we know it.
Yeah, I know. And there's a lot of really great Toronto writers that are going to be out there launching that night, too. So it'll be really fun.
And what's the date again?
November 10th, and that's at the Garrison. And I think it starts at 7.
Yes, I believe it does.
Yeah.
And November 10th. And their launches are always well attended and lots of readers.
Yeah, it's a good celebration for everybody involved.
For everybody involved.
Yeah, and I haven't been to the Garrison yet, so I'm kind of curious about that.
It's kind of like a big box, which I really like for because you can sort of see the room and the stage and the bar is at the back and the door comes in. So it's a fair sized room.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Yeah, you can see everybody and.
Good.
I think it's and I could hear. I was at the back, and I could hear everything. So.
Yeah. Do you think you'll be out this time around? Or are you all booked in?
I have to check my schedule. And, depends on what night it is. It's a Wednesday?
I think it might be a Thursday. It's my mom's birthday, actually, so she's going to be very disappointed that I won't be here for it. But
hopefully she'll understand.
Oh, she will. She will. Yeah.
Yeah. Has she seen the book?
Not yet, no. I've been wanting to spring it on her, but, you know, there's one part of the book that I'm not sure she will be too completely happy with, but we'll see. I'll run it by her very slowly.
Yeah.
I think this is probably the most autobiographical book I've done, and, you know, when you do stuff like that, it doesn't always sit right with the people that you want it to sit right with, so we'll have to work through that if there is an issue.
it's certainly something that has to be considered when you're writing and it's like, well, do I censor myself?
Yeah,
and how much and should
and,
I?
And whose story is whose, right?
That's a tricky one.
It is each time around.
So, are you working on anything now?
Well, I'm kind of writing the joy of finishing this one up, but I did go away on a small weekend retreat, kind of event weekend. I think you have Monty Reid on tonight, or he was on before me.
Monty Reid is next, actually.
He's next. So he was with me on this weekend at Perth, and it was a group of writers, and we had 2 days to sit in the environment. We each had our own little spot, and we were to write about our response to the environment that we were sitting in. And so 2 days to produce something. At the end of the 2 days, there was a reading in this really gorgeous barn and in Perth, organized by Susie Osler, and it was absolutely amazing. And for the first time in probably 3 years, two at least, I wrote a poem. And it was a long poem, and it was, you know, I had actually accumulated text on paper, so I was pretty happy with that. So I'm going to plug away at that. That's going to take me a while, but I'll keep working on it.
And you mentioned about the long poem, that's your favorite form?
It seems to be, yeah. I wish I was able to have material that would let me just write one, like a poem here and a poem there, but I just don't have anything interesting enough to say in that way, so I end up finding one subject and really digging deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper until the point where I'm probably, you know, knocking it dead, but it's more interesting for me that way.
I like the long form format. I think that, yeah, and I think they do, I think the short poem, it serves a different... It's a different type of art.
It feels like a completely different muscle. And just like short story, I couldn't do a short story if I tried. But
I like short stories.
I love reading them.
Yeah. Well, that's good.
Yeah.
All the short story writers will like that.
It's true.
They need readers. So, but yeah, it's good, to, I think, to find your form. But that's what I find with the long poem, is that you can really get into the meat of something.
Yeah, yeah.
And work with your images that way.
And really get that atmosphere to work for yourself, right? So
yeah, that's it. You have time to create atmosphere.
Yeah,
that's
exactly.
Very true. That's really good. I like that atmosphere. It's been a real pleasure talking to you, Sandra.
Thank you very much for having me tonight, Nancy. It was really lovely.
You're very welcome, and good luck with the book launch. And again, it's November
10th. Yep, at the Garrison.
At the Garrison.
And it's a book thug launch, so it's not just me, but a whole ton of really great writers.
And get there early, everybody.
I think so, and I think there's beer and Coca-Cola and whatever you like.
Yeah, there's a bar at the back.
There is. Okay, well, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Sandra.
Okay,
all
have
the
a nice
best.
Night. Okay, you
too.
Bye.
Excuse me, that was Sandra Ridley with her book Sylvia, and is published by Book Thug. And again, the book launch will be November 10th at the Garrison in Toronto. We're going to take a quick break for a song from Chantal Kraviasek, and then we'll be back right away with Monty Reid, and he's in Ottawa. Back. This is CIUT 89.5 FM. Nancy Jane Bullis Greer in the chair tonight. Valentino Asenza will be here next week, so I hope you can tune in for that. I'm sure it will be a fantastic show. And I'm very happy to have on the phone Monty Reid. Hey, Monty.
Hi, Nancy. How are you?
I'm good, thanks. How are you doing?
Not too bad.
Good. I'll just introduce you to our listeners, if they may not be familiar. With you, with your work, Monty Reid is an Ottawa writer. His recent publications include Garden, Chaudière Books, 2014, and the Luskville Reductions, Brick Books, 2008, as well as many chapbooks from Apartment 9, Gaspero, Above Ground, Corrupt, Red Ceilings, and other small presses. He has won the Stephen G. Stephenson Award 3 times, the Archibald Lampman Award, 2 national magazine awards, and has been nominated for the Governor General's Award for Poetry on 3 occasions. He is the managing editor of Arc Poetry Magazine and the director of Verse Fest, Ottawa's international poetry festival. Welcome to HOWL.
Well, thank you kindly. I'm glad to be here.
Yeah, it's nice to meet you. And what is Verse Fest?
Verse Fest is a poetry festival. It's been going on, well, now gearing up for our 7th year. We have a small but really very dynamic festival with about 60 or 70 poets from around the world every year.
Wow. And what is it at a special time every year?
Every March, March 21 to 26 in 2017.
Oh, okay. I'll write that down. And where is it?
It's in downtown Ottawa in a venue called the Knox Presbyterian Church, right on Elgin Street for anyone who's familiar with Ottawa. So that's right downtown, and the Knox is often used for cultural programming.
I think I've been to a poetry reading there. Is that possible?
It's certainly possible.
Yeah. This would be in the 90s. This was
maybe.
A long
maybe.
Time ago.
yeah, some of us remember.
So this book is called Meditatio Placentae?
Yeah, Meditatio Placentae.
Meditatio Placentae. And that's a section in the book?
Yep, that's the title poem of the book.
And I guess, I was just talking to Sandra Ridley about the long poem, and it seems that that's what these are as well. They're broken up into sections, but then each one is like its own theme.
That's true. There are a number of poems in the book, but they all tend to be long sequences, anywhere from 6 or 7 to 20-some pieces that belong to the individual groupings. That seems to be my default mode. I certainly never deliberately set out to write sequences or long poems, but that's the way things seem to be moving.
I like this. It's different from most poetry that I read, that it's not in this form. And you have a sense of humor that I don't know, is it intended or it's just I never know with some of it's like
yeah no I mean there are certainly intended to be funny moments in the poems, but the poems certainly have a seriousness to them.
Exactly. Yeah, that's why I hesitated with the how to frame the question.
Yeah, I understand. I'm not offended. There are deliberately funny moments in the poems.
And I guess that reflects life, too. That's
exactly true.
You can be going through a horrendous time, and yet there are moments when you know, you might find yourself laughing at something. Totally.
And you're probably better off for it if you do.
I think so. I think that, it gets pretty heavy if there's no break. Yeah. In between it, for sure. So how did you come to publish with Brick Books?
Well,
you've published with them before.
This is the second book of mine that Brick has published, and I don't know. I met Barry Dempster at a reading at some point, and we chatted. There was no actual invitation or anything, but I thought, okay, I think this might be a place that would be interested in the kind of writing I'm doing. And that's not always the case. I write other styles, and that it may not be such a good fit with Brick, but this particular book I think is, and certainly Luskville Reductions was a good fit as well. And I knew Brick by reputation, and that reputation was extremely good. Mm-hmm. And certainly I've felt in my experience with them that they do a great job. They don't have oodles of resources, but man, they certainly maximize what they've got, and I'm really grateful for it.
It's a beautiful book. With the pages, they've got the, I can't remember what the pages are called when they do a different color.
Oh, yeah.
Inside the book, the black pages.
Yeah, yeah, they've done it really nicely.
And is this is an illustration on the cover of Tweezers?
The Tweezers on the cover, we actually gave Tweezers away at the book launch. The Tweezers on the cover come from one of the really short poems in the book called, what is it, Household Gods?
It's in Household, yeah, I guess that's where I thought the humor.
Yeah, where it actually speaks of a set of tweezers.
And so you've got it there. In the, would you like to read from your book?
Sure. Is there anything in particular you'd like to hear?
I'm just trying to think. I did quite like the House of the Household Gods.
All right. The Household Gods are among the briefest poems in the book, and they're just they were written, and also among the oldest. These poems go back at least 20 years.
Wow.
And the Household Gods were published in Prairie Fire ages ago. And at least 20 years ago, more than that, now that I think of it. So they're one of the throwbacks, and you can see a little bit different style at work there in that they tend to be more imagistic than some of my later work, which is a little more discursive than some of these small poems. But I still like them, and I'm quite happy to read a few of them. Why don't you let me read Tweezers?
Okay.
This is one poem in a selection of about, oh, I don't know, a dozen or so. And they're all about small things that you would find around your house. Tweezers. At the far, hard end of their existence, these two old friends cannot do without each other. But today, they're not speaking. Something has come between them, and now it's gone.
And listening to Monty Reid from his book Meditatio Placentae, and it's published by Brick Books. Excuse me. Thank you. And the title poem, Meditatio Placentae. How did this come about?
It was written about the birth of my young daughter, well, now 6-year-old daughter, and some of the complications that followed that birth, which essentially was a retained placenta. And everybody ended up fine, but there were a few tense moments in the emergency room as my wife was being prodded and while they were discovering what the issue was. And so I ended up writing a poem that I thought was going to be a celebration of my daughter's birth, and it ended up about in a completely tangential way and with a kind of a swerve talking about the placenta that came out too eventually.
This is CIUT 89.5 FM, and we're talking to Monty Reid, who is about to read from his book, Meditatio Placentae, published by Brick Books.
Okay, this is yet another sequence of poems, and I'm just going to read a couple pieces from it.
Okay.
I came out, too, with just as much necessity, but none of the adoration. I have to assume the world will contain us, not the mother or the child, but something unembraceable and always between this place and another. The midwife took me in her gloves and spread me on the cold tray. She said I was complete, but that has never been true. Even now, I want the rest of me to show up and be similarly loved.
There was one about angels.
Oh, yeah. sure. I'll read that one, too.
Okay.
It's a little bit later in the sequence. And it's,
I'm trying to find it, yeah.
Number four.
Yeah.
And I was struck by, in the delivery room, with all the attendants standing around with gowns on, of course, and I was just thinking of the drapery that you see on all sorts of medieval paintings, and the resemblance struck me. I came out, and it is the going out that still concerns us, with a kind of plop. Not exactly the celestial soundtrack all the attendants in their hospital gowns expected, and for a while, I am in and out of the body, like the soul escaping in one of those voluptuous old paintings with angels instead of midwives, but with the same drapery. They were supposed to examine me, but with all that bright light and finery, who can blame them for a certain distraction? The body always retains something of what it gives up, a trace of what's gone. But of course, the body has also been given up by something with different audio. I came out with a kind of plop, and then there was another, but less emphatic plop, when they dropped me in the yogurt tub so the angels can carry me back home.
Thank you. You're listening to Monty Reid read from his book, Meditatio Placentae, published by Brick Books. Do you have any readings coming up, Monty?
I do have a couple. Not in Ontario, though. I'm heading out west to my old stomping grounds. A few days, let's see, October 11th and 12th on the...
Oh, nice.
11th, I'm in Edmonton, and on the 12th, I'm in Saskatoon. So I'm looking forward to that because... I was born in Saskatchewan and lived much of my life in Alberta, so I get to go back to
nice.
See some old friends.
Yeah, sounds good. It was a pleasure talking to you, and all the best.
Thank you kindly, and best to you as well.
Thank you, Monty.
Okay.
Take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye. This is CIUT 89.5 FM, and we're just speaking with Monty Reid about his book, Meditatio Placentae, which is published by Brick Books, and we spoke... earlier to Sandra Ridley, and we started off with Ingrid Ruthig, and we're just going to close out with a track from 5440. Please stick around for Sex City at 11 o'clock. Valentino Essenza will be here next week, and I'll be back in two. And have a great night, and remember, please, lights on bikes. Good night.